Lilly.
Thank you. I'd particularly like to thank the members for Blaxland and Dobell for moving this motion. It is true that early detection is always the best protection. And of course, the screening of men now is seen as something that is entirely normal and something that has the universal support of the medical profession. It wasn't always so. And back in the days when Jim Lloyd and I moved the first motion in this parliament about raising awareness of prostate cancer, that advice of early detection is the best protection and universal screening was opposed by substantial elements of the medical profession. So it's great to see how far we've come. So I'd particularly like to pay tribute to the work of the Prostate Cancer Foundation, and in particular its former chairman, Graham Johnson, who was honoured in the Australia Day Awards for his very substantial work over many years for raising awareness about prostate cancer. There have, of course, been many others, and Jim Lloyd is one, many other tireless advocates in our community who have saved lives through raising awareness. So I come to this debate and discussion with a great deal of personal experience. I can stand here and say that I am one of the lucky ones. And had things been otherwise different, if I didn't have a switched-on GP, I would not be here today. Now, of course, that might be pleasing to one or two around the place, but nevertheless, I was the beneficiary of a switched-on GP who, for no other reason than the fact that she was acutely aware of how dangerous this disease is, that she gave me a PSA test without me actually going to the doctor to ask for it specifically, because there were no symptoms. And there are so many who have no symptoms who are not detected, and as a consequence of not being detected, die a very painful and excruciating death. So early detection is the best protection. And I'm evidence, if you like, of someone who was detected early and has gone on to live a life which has been unaffected by my prostate cancer, its diagnosis, or its subsequent treatment. But what my case says is something really powerful about what needs to be done. Because whilst I was diagnosed in 2001, my father, also a digger from World War I, survived the war, but he didn't survive prostate cancer. In 1989, he died from prostate cancer, an agonising death, age 67. And I was only 35 when he passed away. And like most men of my age, I was entirely unaware, as a consequence of his prostate cancer, that I was at a much higher degree of risk from having prostate cancer, but entirely unaware of that. And I didn't think about my vulnerability until I was actually diagnosed 12 years after his death in a sudden call from my GP telling me I'd had an adverse test. And as I said before, the test wasn't taken because I'd gone to the doctor complaining about any symptoms, because prostate cancer for many is a silent killer, and that is why it is so dangerous. And having watched a father die a painful death from prostate cancer, I was blissfully unaware at that stage that I had any high degree of risk. And in fact, at that stage, there was a lot of advice flowing around from shonks in the medical profession, saying words to the effect that you don't die from, you die with prostate cancer. And that was used by many to argue the case against testing, universal testing, whatever the age you want, plus 40, plus 50. What most men still don't know, and this is where there's a huge communication exercise yet to take place, is that if they have a first-degree relative who has suffered from prostate cancer, the risk of having cancer isn't 1 in 10, isn't 1 in 7, it is 1 in 3. And that number is not really out there. So there are still many people who are highly at risk of prostate cancer who are blissfully unaware of the need to be tested. And of course, testing doesn't come easily to many men who don't necessarily want to have the challenging task, in their terms, of seeing a choice, if you like, between their long-term health or some particular impact, for example, on their sex life. So there are still many more lives yet to be saved, with 17,000 new cases each year, over 3,000 men dying, so much more work to be done. The good news is survival rates are going up dramatically. That is largely a result of the great work of people like Professor Tony Costello, Phil Stricker and others, and the Prostate Cancer Foundation, that have been so successful not only in raising awareness but also in the technological advance that's come through robotics and many other achievements. And also, I'll finish on saying, the prostate centres that we established in government as part of our comprehensive approach to make sure that men survive prostate cancer.